First, I'd say how much I genuinely appreciate the opportunity to be here. We've had this planned for a long time. This is my fifth or sixth or seventh time to do this year, and it's my sideline. My regular job is the development director for a children's home, a Church of Christ children's home. And so I'm in a different church every Sunday, but I especially want to do these seminars as much as I can. Let me give a little background on this. I went to Oklahoma Christian. One of my primary professors, one of the elders at the Britton Road Church of Christ now, he would work into his lecture every day how, as Christians, mass communication majors, we were a little more obligated to use it every time we learned a little more. But, you know, 2 years of that, it sinks in after a while. And so years later, I put together a short presentation about television. And then later on, I had to expand it for a class and put together this three-hour version. And I've been doing this now in one form or the other for about 15 years. But let me tell you, it changes. It changes a lot. I did it for 8 years in a row, and then I had to quit because of work responsibilities. I was promoted at work and didn't have time to do this. And then when I reverted back to the previous role, I decided to start doing it again. But the world is different. I'm not talking about the same thing I would have talked about 5 years ago, because things are different. I barely talked about social media before. I spent the single majority of my time talking about violent video games. And some of you are going to come to me afterwards and say, why don't you talk about video games? And I'm going to say, give me about 12 hours to talk, and I'll cover everything that you want me to cover. Other than that, I just have to, you know, this is a terribly complex topic. And so what I'm going to do this morning, in this Bible class teaching class, we're going to look at social media. And this isn't even the same material that I presented earlier in the year, because there's a lot of new data, a lot of new information out there that changes things. And then during the worship period, we're going to look at characteristics of a good Christian family. I used to talk about some of this in the worship period, and I'm sorry, y'all, it was just too dark and depressing to talk about during the worship period. So my lesson is an uplifting lesson that I think will encourage you as well. And then in the afternoon session, we will look at what used to be called electronic battlefields, your child and television, and it is specifically designed for the parents of the younger children, and somewhat for the teenagers as well, to get a grasp on what's really happening with television. Because with our older children, social media is everything. We're going to look at the numbers on that in just a moment. But for our younger kids, it's television. And so let's look at this for a little while. I hope to have time at the end of my presentation for questions. If I don't cover everything in this session right now as I want to, and I probably won't be able to do that, then I will put the last part of this in the afternoon session after our lunch today. If you have any questions, get with me. You can ask me now. I may try to answer it now. I may try to answer it later. And or get with me during the potluck or whatever it is we're doing, and I'll be glad to answer your questions. Let's talk about social media convergence. The reason it's called media convergence, I set my phone over there, I normally pick it up about now. The reason it's called media convergence is because we used to have different channels for all of our information. Now it is all in our phone. Everything I'm going to talk about this morning centers around your smartphone, because that has changed everything. I have a Windows phone. It has PowerPoint. It has Word. It has Excel. It has everything that I need. It has everything my computer at the office will do. Now, it's a whole lot harder to use when it's on that 3D screen, but nevertheless, it's there. And so we need to remember that if I want to watch Netflix, I can do it. If I want to watch my read books on my Kindle account, it's there. Everything's on our phone. And that's the reason it's called media convergence, because it's all converged into our smartphones. And that changes everything, especially with the way our children are using those. And we're going to look at some statistics in just a few minutes about that. After I spent for 5 years and decided to do this again, my original goal was to put together, I realized the real problem here is Facebook morality. And it is. The real problem is we are not teaching basic morality either to ourselves or to our children. And that's where the real problem is. And the products, the media products out there are just part of the problem. So one of the things that I want to emphasize all day long is the solution to all the problems that I'm speaking of is to read the Bible more, pray more, be more like a Christian needs to be. That's the solution to everything we're talking about. This is the media, or the medium, which is a phone, and the media is the product. They're just symbolic of the product. Romans chapter 1, 16-25. By no single person, but it's the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. Before it could be known about God, it's plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For in his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, has been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world, and the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools, and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal men and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up in the lust of their hearts and purity, the dishonoring of their bodies against among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie, and worshiped to serve the Creator rather the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. I'm reading one of the books that I'm going to recommend. I was reading it on the plane yesterday coming in. And so, and again, he emphasizes the issue again that what we've done is we have turned our phones and all of our gadgets into idols. Now, you don't have to think real hard to make that analogy come true in your mind, because we really do idolize. I sat yesterday at the airport and looked at a row of people. There's 20 of them, and looked to see how many of them had their phones on. I have mine out too. All right, okay. But how many of them had their phones on? Another 20, 19 of them had their phones on. We really made an idol out of this, and I struggle with it just as much as all the rest of us. Okay. And even though I'm alluding a whole lot to teenagers, the references in the literature, the references in the research say my generation, and I'm in the middle of those boomers, we're just about as addicted as anybody else. So this, I'm talking to myself as well. I can't speak very long without talking about the generations, because I've done this presentation before, and I would talk about the different generations, and everybody said, we didn't know what you're talking about. All right? So I'm going to take just about 2 minutes to talk about the generations, because a lot of this has to do with that. The greatest generation is my grandparents, who most of them were gone now, born 1901 to 1926. And everybody has different opinions on where these breaks are in generations. This is just the one that I most agree with. Matthias and Silas, that's my dad, my mom. Okay. I'm in the middle of baby boomers. I was born 54. I'm 2 months to be in the dead center of baby boomers. Generation X is my oldest daughter and her husband. They're born between 65 and 80. It's a very small generation, Generation X is. The millennials are the ones that we talk about the most all the time, Generation Y. The term millennials is one that they don't like being called that, but that's the term that stuck pretty well. They're born from 81 to 98. My two younger children are in that category. If one of them talk about the argument, and you've probably never heard of that before, all right? That's a new term. Came out solidly about 2 months ago. It is, in my professional opinion, what we're going to call them. Right? Right now we call them Generation Z. I hate to be called that. Okay? Generation Z are the boomers, which even sounds sillier. We're going to call them IGM. Now these are those, again, the numbers fluctuate according to who you talk to. But these are those that from 1998 to 2012. The ones I'm talking about here are those that are currently from age 5 to about age 19. Let's talk about social media. Real quick rundown. Facebook. It is not the most used platform for teenagers anymore. We'll come to what it is. Anybody want to guess the number one platform for teenagers? The program of all the programs out there, the one teenagers like the best. Somebody want to guess? No. So let's try again. Okay. What's that? What'd you say? No. Not Facebook. I'm going to tell you it's YouTube. All right? YouTube is the most popular site, and I'll tell you why in a few minutes. Twitter is Twitter is used mostly by regional, we'll come back to these specifically. Twitter, popularity fluctuates, goes back and forth. Snapchat, very popular, we'll come back to that again. The content appears and disappears. Blogs are not technically social media, but they're treated like that, all right? So they're linked in with the others. And there's YouTube, which is now the most used channel for teenagers. Let's talk about Facebook. And the reason I'm doing this now is because I know that many of you older adults, my age or up, you don't know what this stuff is. Facebook, look how many users Facebook has. You don't have to be there without more. 1,860,000 subscribers to Facebook. It's social impact, it has literally changed everything. Basically, we interact immediately. My wife has a Facebook account where she puts grandbaby pictures on there. Alright? I check my Facebook account quicker than I check my emails. Why? Because she puts pictures of grandbabies on there about every 4 or 5 hours. Alright? Okay. And so it's very, very popular. Facebook allows users to broadcast and share content. One of our most interesting statistics. The average person signing up for Facebook today, demographically, is a 54-year-old grandma. 54-year-old grandma is the average person signing up for Facebook. Why? Grandbaby pictures. I'm serious. That's one of the biggest uses of Facebook is grandbaby pictures. How about Facebook? Almost half of the world gets on their Facebook account sometime during the day. Y'all, that's almost half of the world gets on Facebook once a day. The last stage is there's a lot of negative effects of Facebook as well. What is the kind of thing we tell everybody on Facebook? What we're doing and how much we're enjoying it. Well, what about if I don't have the chance to go and we're enjoying it? All right? Sort of rude, isn't it? All right? So there's a lot of self-esteem issues with people talking about how wonderful the world is on Facebook, and yet other people read that and don't have the same privileges or the same opportunities to do things. It creates a lot of this depression and division that we have within our society. Let's talk about YouTube. YouTube, for those of you that aren't familiar with it, is a video sharing site. You can go to YouTube right now and get almost word for word what we're doing right now. Because I did it 3 weeks ago at the Boonville, Mississippi Church House. They recorded all of it, and 2 hours later, it was on YouTube. Just type in my name in YouTube, and all three of them will show up. You get to see just how much I repeat myself. But nevertheless, YouTube is, but the reason YouTube is so popular with our teens, and this is in the last year that it became the most popular. What is the one thing that we claim this generation, I'm talking about the youngest generation, what do they not want to do? Read. They don't want to read. Okay? So why on earth did you read the instructions on something when you go to YouTube and they tell you how to do it? So that's what YouTube is used for. It's used for anything. If you want anything at all, our teenagers will typically, not all of them, but typically, go to YouTube. Y'all, I had to rewrite a status plan for the travel trailer we have out in the woods over these Texas. Okay? It's not really safe for a guy that doesn't know anything. I know a lot about that kind of stuff. It's not really safe to do that. But you know, I watched that video on YouTube, 4 different versions, 5 times. I felt confident that I could weld that service pole together. All right? I've done it and it works fine. All right? That's what YouTube is good for. You can learn anything from YouTube. Think of it as one day. Okay? And that doesn't count all the musical videos and so on that are there. I took a whole song reading class on YouTube one time. All right? Sort of cool. YouTube is the most popular online destination for teenagers. Now, there's a problem with YouTube. I try not to talk about pornography too much, but you can't not talk about pornography and talk about social media. The number one use of the internet right now is pornography. Do you hear that? The number one use of the internet power in the entire world right now is pornography. It outranks emails, it outranks Facebook, it outranks everything. So that is the real issue here. Now, porn is prohibited on YouTube. However, if you've got that many million people putting stuff on there, that means there's 24 hours of new videos put on YouTube every minute. That's what the research that I saw yesterday said. Do they have time to monitor all of that? Does anybody have time to monitor all that? No, they don't. So the problem with YouTube is not only can there be bad stuff on there, and there is bad stuff on there, But the problem is you talk about things and you put links on video sites about other things. And when you do that, it is really easy to put links to bad places. So, you as parents need to be concerned about where your child is going to on YouTube. We'll talk about a few ways of controlling that in a little bit. YouTube management repeatedly promises to address these concerns, but they're just too big. All right? YouTube is just too big to control that. In March 2016, the Daily Star reported that on Instagram, there were 1 million explicit porn films found on Instagram. And this is an extremely popular channel for our children. It can't suggest that we can't control access to porn. We can't. And that's the reason we have to talk about the moral side of this. What are you teaching your children related to that? It bothers me to talk about this, but it's the world we live in. Instagram, 600 million subscribers to Instagram. Twitter's in the news all the time. Sorry about the typo there. Twitter's in the news all the time because our president loves Twitter. But it's mostly used by older guys. 313 million. Yes, I have a Twitter account, but I don't know how to use it. All right? I signed up for it. Okay. But it's just, I have better things to do. All right? Now, let's talk about Snapchat. Now, one time I got Snapchat and Instagram backwards. And believe me, I caught it with the kids for that. Snapchat, so I think I got straight this time. Photos and videos usually disappear in about 10 seconds. 30% of the youth in a national survey claim that they use it specifically because their parents don't use it. So they feel they have a sense of freedom. The average person uses it 18 times a day. And 54% of all American teens claim to use it every day. That's 54% of all American teens claim to use it every day. 166,000 users, not that many, that's per day. Okay, 30 million a month. Pinterest, I call that the 50 channel, all right? 83% of the users are women. It's all pretty pictures and flowers and bouquets and ribbons. And I haven't figured out, how to use it yet. Okay, all right. This is sort of our ultimate marketing tool. Those of us that are into internet marketing. It is what it is. 150 million subscribers, 83% of them female. LinkedIn is now owned by Google. It's 106 million. You have to put some version of your resume on LinkedIn in order to be on LinkedIn. So it really is for networking. And I use it a little bit for that. Me and 200 people that I'm connected with on LinkedIn. We're basically brag about our job on LinkedIn. Okay. We talk about the good things. If we get promoted, we talk about it. If we're moving, we talk about it and so on. But it's also good for finding jobs. Okay. That's what it's mostly used for, is to take those connections if you're in a job change situation. I want you to catch this is the cover of a book that I'm about to talk about for quite a while. The name of the book is, and this book came out about a month ago, maybe a month and a half ago, The Smartphone Generation, A Statistical Portrait. I want to read what it says, because you probably can't see that in the book. The constant presence of the internet, particularly social media, is changing the behavior and attitudes of teens today. This is something. Today's super connected kids are growing up less rebellious, more tolerant, less happy, and completely unprepared for adulthood. And what that means for the rest of us. The reason I pay so much attention to this is because for the years that I've been doing this, almost everything I've told you about the various generations was my opinion or somebody else that I know's opinion. Okay? What I'm about to give you is not opinion anymore. This lady took 40 years of studies, 10 different studies, 10 different statistical studies, took 40 years, and she analyzed this. And what she came up with is not all bad. You know, some of it's actually good, and some of it is not good. I want to look at this because it just shows you the impact that the phone, the smartphone, is having. Now, for what you need to know here, what matters on all this charge is this line right here. That's when the smartphone came out. On every one of these charts, the next 3, 4, 5 charts, that's when the smartphone came out. iPhone was released. Now, this is hanging out with their friends. Now, you might think it's a good thing that your children are hanging around with their friends. Depends on who the friends are. But look what's happened to the numbers. That first number there on the far left is 1976, and then it goes all the way down. Look at what it's at now. Are our kids irreplaceable? I mean, they're doing about nothing of Disney. Why? Because they're in their rooms playing on their phones. That's about nothing. They're in their rooms playing on their phones. And there's quote after quote after quote from the lady who surveyed teenagers all over the country. Says, I'd rather be on my phone talking to my friends than talking to them face to face. Now, what does that create? Now, I'm going to be practical for a moment. It's not necessarily a Christian issue, but a practical issue. What does that mean? It means they don't know how to talk to anybody. They don't know how to shake hands. They don't know how to meet anybody. Okay? Basically, they're socially, absolutely inept. Not all of them, but they're getting that way. And you don't have to hang around very many of them to do it. I work with teenagers. I'm at a children's home. We've got 30 teenagers there. It is happening. How about the other end of that? What does all that time alone do? If you're in your room by yourself, are you going to be happy socially? So look what happens in that same time period. And notice what pivots the minute the phone came out. All right? More likely to fill memory. This is the percentage of 8th, 10th, and 12th graders who agree or mostly agree with the statement, I'll often feel left out of things, a lot of times I feel lonely. We have a problem with depression, and it's been caused by the phone. That's plainly put. We have a problem with depression, and it's being caused by a smartphone. Okay, and this one here, though, it's not so dramatic, but that line there indicates when the phone came out, less likely to get enough sleep. Why? They're in their rooms playing on their phones. Now, does that mean I'm against smartphones? No, I love my smartphone. All right? Does it mean there's some problems that could be created? Now, this is the one thing most interesting. Now, you don't have to open these questions. Everybody in these questions, on their 16th birthday, how long is a weekday? If that's the 16th birthday on a weekday, that's good school that day if they have to go get their driver's license. It was a big, big deal. I don't know anybody that didn't get their driver's license on their 16th birthday. All right? Statistically, according to this latest report, and that's just in my generation, 1972, 80% of us had our driver's licenses by the beginning of our senior year. Right now, 40% of the teenagers have their driver's license at the end of their senior year. They couldn't walk their driver. Why? Well, mom and dad are hauling them around. And that's not me talking about, okay? About half these problems we're talking about here, not that many. A lot of them are related to the phone, but the rest of it's related to 9/11, if you study it carefully. Our parents are scared for their children. And so they're being overprotective. And that's not me talking. That's the statistics talking. The parents are being overly protective. Look at this one. Dating's not directly related. The dating has gone down. All right? Okay. Now, let me give you the two that I don't put trust up there for. Alcohol usage has dropped immensely. Why? Because you got to usually go somewhere and be public. At least meet other people to drink alcohol. All right? So alcohol usage has actually gone down. Sex has gone down a lot. But it takes two people. All right? And if you're in your room by yourself, probably not. So again, it all has to do with that issue. The other one I left out is, and it's mostly because people were offended by it, but I'll tell you what it was. Statistically, the average 15-year-old acts like a 12-year-old. That's not me talking. That's the social scientist. The average 15-year-old acts like a 12-year-old. The average 18-year-old acts like a 15-year-old. And the average 21-year-old acts like an 18-year-old. There's a 3-year gap in maturity now. Now, yeah, we had a problem before this all started. And now it is even more significant, and it's all blamed on smartphones and parents over-nurturing of their children. I talked to parents after these presentations. I asked them, am I right? Do you over-nurture your children? Do you go to the mall with them instead of letting them go by themselves? Do you call them places, do this and this and so on? And everyone that I talked to said, yeah, we want our kids to be safe. I'm not saying that's good or bad, but that's the difference of what we're dealing with, maybe. Let's talk about the most dangerous issues. These are the three that you need to be most concerned about. Sexting, online predators, and cyberbullying. A lot of people don't know how prevalent sexting is. What sexting is, sending, receiving, or forwarding sexual photos or sexually suggested messages through a text message or email, usually drawings, photographs, or videos. And the national study, about 20% of teens admitted, 20% nationally speaking, admitted sending a sexual photograph, and 40% admitted having received one. Of the 20% that received a sexting message, 5% admitted forwarding to someone else. The problem here is they don't know how illegal this is. 10 years ago, a teacher at a school in Tennessee, he confiscated a phone. It was a phone that had a picture of a girl who had sent a nude photograph of herself to her boyfriend, both under 16 years old. He called the sheriff. Anybody want to guess what happened? He went to jail. He was possessed of child pornography. All right? It's a real problem. The mother's now beginning to catch up on that. He spent 3 weeks in jail, according to the report I read. It's beginning to catch up on that. Our kids don't realize just how legal this is. When a child sends that or receives that, they're in possession of child pornography. I work at Cherokee Home. I work with children. We have all teenagers. If we suspect that there is something bad on the phone, we don't turn that phone on. We'll never turn that phone on. We'll call the church. We'll let the church turn that phone on. Because we don't want those children. That's how serious this is. The peak age for sexting is 16 to 17 years old. And guess what? When the little ones are old enough to really get in trouble, they quit. All right? So did that tell you they know what they're doing is illegal? Yeah. But you know, this has all sorts of this creates all sorts of problems. There's emotional consequences of the fact that, you know, nothing ever really goes away on the internet. I checked that. The very first time my name was on the internet was for a class I was teaching in 2002 at Will College. My syllabus was on the internet. Did you know if you look hard enough, you can still find that 15 years later? Nothing ever really goes away. If you don't believe me, ask the police officer. They can figure out how to get anything that was ever on the internet. The message the photo gets can get to the wrong people. They can be embarrassing. Now, we're going to talk about cyberbullying in just a couple of minutes. One of the ways that cyberbullying occurs is somebody gets an improper photograph of you or something that's embarrassing, and they threaten you with it. Reputations can be ruined. Lives can be changed. One church called me down for saying that sexting was stupid, but y'all, that's the only word for it. It's stupid. Right? It should not be done. And your kids need to know just how dangerous it is and how illegal it is, not counting the morality side of it. Legally, the person sending it can be prosecuted for child pornography. What about predators, though? Now, I have to admit, I haven't had to deal very much with this. It seems to be much more of a problem than what I'm personally aware of. It has to do with sex trafficking and things like that. And fortunately, I haven't had to work in those fields. But 1 in 7 kids will receive a sexual solicitation online. 44% of sexual predators are under 18, typically boys. All right? The victims are usually 13 to 15. The victims are 75% female, 25% male. And it often starts off by asking for picture, which leads to more explicit pictures and so on. And this is interesting. 14% of all high school students at some time or another have agreed to meet a stranger they met online. And that's a start of some very, very bad things. It's risky behavior. It starts off with posting personal information. It starts off with interacting with strangers online, facing strangers you don't know on their buddy list or their friends list, sending personal information to people that should not be getting that personal information. They start visiting pornographic sites. They start talking about sex with strangers. Warning signs. Secretive about their activities. They become obsessed with being online. They get angry when you take them offline or they can't get online. And they get calls from people you don't know. If you see any of those things, they really do happen. There's a slide that I took out that was the head of the FBI in this department saying, do not suspect that because of your socioeconomic level that you are exempt from this. That statistically, every socioeconomic level is in every ethnicity are all equal in the prevalence of online predators. Get strange packages, They change the screen as soon as you walk up to the screen or to their phone, and they download pornography. Now, cyberbullying. I did make that little one real small. I meant to make that bigger. It is a bigger problem than you think. What cyberbullying is, and this is the only slide I have on it, what it is, it's where someone threatens someone with online content. The example would be, I've got a picture of you. This is what I think of when I think of cyberbullying. I've got a picture of you getting undressed in the gym. Your girlfriend, I mean, all of us wouldn't want that to be on the internet, would they? Because it could be done at school. Or, I have a photograph that your boyfriend sent to you. If you don't do this and this for me, I'm going to make sure that's seen all over the world. It's a problem. I did this presentation at a church in Houston, suburb of Houston, Jersey Village. And at the end of the presentation, I put together the 35 topics that I talked about. And I asked all the moms, this was a vacation Bible school for me. And it was I had 14 kids, 14 girls and 14 boys, that were working in vacation Bible school, taking care of the little ones, and their moms were there. So I asked all of them this survey. I said, if there's 35 things, mark the 5 things you think are most important. Not a single mom marked cyberbullying. We didn't call it cyberbullying back then. We called it cell phone bullying. All right? None of them marked it. Every single boy marked it as number one. And these were the same boys whose parents said it's not a problem. And most of the girls, all the girls had it in the top 5. What does that tell me? It tells me that parents are generally unaware of how big of an issue this is. And 16-year-old boy that woke up to mom and said, Mom, I'm being bullied on the phone. No, that's not macho. All right? So what I recommend parents do is you ask your kids, especially boys. And it's now becoming more prevalent with girls. It used to be almost all boys. Now it's increasing with girls. Ask them if they have a problem with them. And if you need help, nothing else, call law enforcement. Because they've got departments out there that will deal specifically with this. They take it serious. And the reason that it's becoming more and more of a problem with it is becoming more and more a problem, I don't know the reason, it's becoming more and more of a problem with girls. And that is one of the, if you read the news at all, you know, that's one of the primary reasons for the increase in suicide. It's because of cyberbullying and things of that sort. We've got a lot of news about that lately. Other risky behaviors. They used to be big. Okay. My slide didn't work there. Supposed to be 5 things there in big print. Partying pictures. That's hard to say. Partying pictures. That means if you put pictures of yourself, the pictures you're not supposed to be. Who's that famous swimmer? Michael Phelps. Okay. Is he the one? What's that? Yeah. What's that? Ryan Locks it. Okay. Yeah, no, I've heard that though. You know, you do, if you're a really, really famous person, or even if you're not a famous person, you don't want pictures just like a pot on the internet. Okay? And those kind of things are happening. So partying pictures. But also there's comparing yourselves. Okay? If you compare yourself with the rest of the world, is somebody else gonna make themselves look better than you? Yes, they are. And this has to do with social perception issues. Number 3, I don't know if I remember all 5, but I know number 3 is inappropriate dress. All right? Inappropriate dress. Do you really want that dress where you have very, very little on to beat your main picture on Facebook? All right? What does that say about your reputation? What does that say about your morals and so on? Another one that I can remember is the boys, particularly, trying to make viral videos. All right? This is a real problem. They try to do something really, really stupid. All right? And they say they want to make a viral video. This is a common situation if you start looking at it. And they'll do something really stupid, you know, jump off this building, you know, try to fly, do this kind of experiment, all sorts of things like that. So that they can get viral on the internet. All right? A lot of kids are dying doing that, y'all. All right? So that's another problem as well. Number 5, I think of it later. My time is almost up. I'm going to very, very quickly go through the concepts or the issues related to pornography. Recent pornography did take over to emails. While about half of Americans over 25 believe it's basically wrong, for those that are under 25, only a third of them believe it's wrong. Now, this is from the Barna. This is not me, y'all. This is from the Barna Research Group put this together. And this is the one I couldn't believe. Most teens and young adults view using porn as less wrong and not recycling. It's not a moral issue then, y'all. Why? Here's why. Because they've already been conditioned. According to the FBI, the average age for a child to start consuming hardcore pornography is 11. And four out of five 16-year-olds regularly access porn online. And I'm going to tell you a statistic that you're not going to want to hear. Within our religious fellowship, we're almost always statistically normal. We are almost always statistically normal. There's very few issues within our entire society that we within the Church of Christ are not normal. I don't think we're quite that normal. I hope and pray we're not. But statistically, we probably, the statistics would tell us we are. Right? So it's an issue. True story. Oklahoma Christian. I'm not from a Christian graduate. The opening day, this is about 8 years ago tonight, the opening day of school, the first year they got computers. And all those kids come in a week early. And they gave me permission to tell the story. I'm an Oklahoma Christian graduate. They gave all those kids computers. And they told them that they gave them full access to the internet that first night. They didn't tell them they were recording what they did. Now, these are all the gifted and talented students that come for the week ahead of time. All right? Gave them all their computers. 75% of them now went to porn sites. Boys and girls equally. All right? They told them that they did it. They told them they caught it. And they rebuked them the next day. But now 50% of them did it again anyway. All right? And the school gave me permission to tell that story. That's how prevalent pornography is with our children. 7 out of your 10 children will come across it online. You can't help it, y'all. You can't help it. All right. 24% of teens, 14 to 17, have been involved in some kind of sexting. 20% of teens have sent a nude photograph of themselves. I don't want to not talk about a couple of tools. I haven't heard the first bell yet, have I? Okay. I'm already here. The little tools out there on your PC, you can, your phone gives you the ability to program their phone so that certain places can't be gone to, certain things can't be done. It's not easy to do. You may have to break out the owner's manual, but phones can be programmed. The parents can program the phones. It works. Pay special attention to the games and the chat sites that your children are going to. You can control, like I said, specific internet sites if you want to. The best thing you can do is sit with them, find out where they're going, and go to those same places yourself to see what it looks like. You do need to monitor your child's video use as well as you can. It's impossible to monitor it completely as well as you can. A lot of tools available. Whether you have an Apple phone or an Android, their profiles can set up limitations. It's not easy to do, but it can be done. Children under 13, by the way, are not allowed to be on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, legally, if they're on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, so they're allowed. All right? Somebody guilty of federal fraud. All right? You need to set up your own account and shadow theirs. If they have a teenager at home right now, I would be a friend of theirs on Facebook. All right? It doesn't mean you have to look like mom or dad. Get your avatar or whatever those things are called. All right? And a substitute name, but be their friend so that you know where they're going and what they're doing. You need to have their passwords. You need not have a teenager that you don't have their passwords. Period. To the phone, to the internet account, everything. With the choice that is so easily available, dangers override privacy. Now, teenagers are going to hate me for saying what I'm saying next. The U.S. Constitution related to privacy does not apply to teenagers. It doesn't. Those issues that we consider privacy come into effect when you're 18-year-old and an adult. All right? Parents have complete control of all those issues legally until you turn 18 years old. Remember that. And remember that you need to be the parent that's willing to maintain that control. So don't ever let a child tell you that you're violating my constitutional rights. I've been having parenting for years and years. I've heard that a thousand times. No. They don't have those constitutional rights until they're 18 years old. Remember that. remember that the moral issues here and the legal issues here override those privacy concerns. Yeah, you didn't let your child grow up and be their own. I'll talk about that in my sermon in a few minutes. Okay. But at the same time, you need to be careful. Add apps that monitor the teen's social behavior. Apps that are free to very expensive. They work. Okay. The only problem with filters, I'm going to tell you point blank, the problem with filters is medical terms and sexual terms are often the same terms. All right. So forget good. Don't put a filter on your computer, a real strong filter on your computer, and then try to look up your medicine, all right, or your medical issues, because those terms are so similar most of the time, you know, that it's a problem for adults. I do a lot of medical research on my computer. Right. Encourage your teen to be responsible, and if you're still using a PC and not your phone, the best thing you can do is put that PC on the kitchen table. I mean that very sincerely. Now, let me be real honest here. It needs to be on the kitchen table not for the sake of the children, but also for the sake of the adults. All right? Because remember that number there on pornography? All right? 75% of all the men in America view pornography regularly. 75%. And remember, we are pretty well statistically normal. All right? So pay attention to that. Put the family computer on the kitchen table. Everything is available to anybody on the phone. Period. We need to teach our children what is right and wrong according to biblical moral standards. And I'll talk about those a little bit more later. But it's all converged on our phones. Now, do I really have 5 minutes left? So I tell you. Okay. All right. Y'all's watch is a little bit different. I have to play with mine for that. For those of you that are educators, you may recall that Piaget put together some stages of educational development, something to that effect. I'm not trained as an educator, but I've read across this stuff indirectly. A few years later, Lawrence Tolbert took those stages of educational development and he put together stages of moral development. And he came up with this chart here, and I have a purpose at the end of this. The first off with egocentric. A little baby is not too concerned about anything but how wet or dirty or hungry they are. All right? If they grow up a little bit, they learn what they can do to stay out of trouble, they learn that they get in trouble, and they learn that if they do things right, they get rewards and so on. Typically, that's 3-4-year-old. At about 5, they begin to pick up a little bit of worldly content. They think about what makes me and my little group of buddies happy. What can we do? This is the 5-year-old, 6-year-old having a little treehouse buddy party, things of that sort. And finally, as they grow into teenagers, they learn to go to the limits of what keeps me out of trouble. I'm going to do everything I can up to the point where I get in trouble and I quit. But they go past that. They grow into what would a moral, right-thinking person think or do. It's a Christian principle. Or, right is the conscious decision of personal ethics that appeals to logic, morality, and consistency. Another Christian principle. But here's what the long-term research has said. You know people that never got past number 4? What do I do? Admit it. You know people that never got past, well, how much can I do and not get in trouble? If your child, according to the researchers, if your child ever moves from number 4 to number 5, and we want all of our children to move from number 4 to number 5, if they ever do that, it will go through the influence, always, through the influence of the primary parent figure in their life. Whoever that primary parent figure is. Now, sometimes, you know, that's not mom and dad. Sometimes that's a teacher. Sometimes it's a youth minister. Sometimes it's a minister. We like it to be mom and dad. But that primary parent figure in their life determines whether they move into this Christian principle or not. That means we as parents, or grandparents, you as a grandparent may be the primary parent figure in your child's life, your grandchild's life. It means you need to take this seriously. We can't just be passive about what we're doing. We have to be very active about it. This is the list of the books that I strongly recommend. The first one I mentioned in detail. The Dick Wise Family by Andy Crouch. We're going to look at that at the beginning of the session after lunch. It's actually next on this presentation, but I'm not going to get there. Last Child in the Woods is one of my favorite books. It's about how to get your child outside. How to get your child outside. Even if you live in the city, how to get your child outside. Because thinking is different when you're outdoors and away from your phone. as complicated as an excellent book about the social life of network teams. It's actually written from a positive perspective. And then there's one other, American Girls, is the beginning of the title. I don't remember the name, long title. It's not listed here. It's a very, very negative side of this issue. Media Choices was the book I was reading yesterday. It's very, very strongly Christian context. And then Parenting Well in the Media Age, that's for you parents that have already lost this battle. Now, let's come to this kind. So we've already lost this battle. So Parenting Well in the Media Age helps you regain that control. It gives you some techniques that really, really will work. So those are available for you. But I don't have time for these. I've got time for maybe one question or two. Anybody got anything they want me to address right now? Otherwise, we're free. Well, thank you. Please come back. My sermon is not directly related to media, but it's about how to be a good Christian family. And then this afternoon, we'll start off with this section right here about 10 tech-wise commitments to the family, and we'll look at TV in great detail. I want to say a prayer, and then we'll go. Thank you, God, for giving us another day. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to learn how to help our families. We need your strength. In Jesus' name, amen.